morning, church. How's everybody doing? Okay, Jody's awake. Would you guys stand with me? I would like to read you a psalm. I'm losing my voice, so bear with me. This is Psalm 19, and I just feel like the Lord gave it to me this morning. It's one of my favorite psalms, and I think it's a good word for us to start our day. Psalm 19 starts with, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech, they use no words, no sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens God has pitched a tent for the sun. It is like a bridegroom coming out of the chamber, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth." And verse 7, "The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm and altogether righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned, and in keeping them there is a great reward. But who can discern their own errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then I will be blameless, innocent of great transgression. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer." Amen. That's a good word. I just want to start in prayer. Father, I just want to thank you for your word, Lord. We stand in honor of your word because we know, Lord, that is the only thing that will not return void in the end. And we just, we thank you for this wonderful day that we get to worship you. And we want you to know that you are the head of this church, Jesus. And we're here because of you. So, Father, I just pray for you to do a new thing in our heart this morning. And we're grateful for the family that's in this house. In Jesus' name, and God's people said, amen. Amen. Welcome, and let's worship.
We pour out our praise. Lord, the earth will the kids would want to go back into the back for children's church.
Thank you for your presence this morning, Jesus. Thank you that we get to step right in and encounter you this morning, Jesus. Help us to lay down everything that would keep us from you. Anything that would come between you and me this morning, God, we lay it down at your feet. Bad things, good things, we lay it all down at your feet this morning, God. We just want to enjoy your presence, God. Worship you this morning because you're worthy. You're worthy. My soul. for a minute. Just tell him this morning how much you love him. Just pour out your heart to him this morning. Oh, we love you, Jesus.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. And God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You should know just what to do.
because you asked that. We believe in you.
Father, we come before you this morning declaring that we do believe in you. We believe every word that you have given us, that you have written for us, that you speak to us. And we come before you with joy. We come before you with gladness. We come before you with thanksgiving. We praise you. You are good. We thank you that you are our Father, that you are our God. And we honor you, Lord, and we worship you this morning. And that's what we are here for this morning, is to give you completely our attention, to give you our hearts, to give you our minds, to come before you. We thank you, Father, that your word will go forth this morning and that you will do what pleases you. We thank you, Father, that you have come to heal the brokenhearted, that you have come to give us joy instead of mourning, that you have come to restore, to renew, to heal, only things that you can do. We thank you, Father, the word that you have for us this morning is going to be like honey, and it's going to be applied to our eyes, our spiritual eyes and our physical eyes, and that there will be sight for those who are blind. And we thank you, God, for the work that you and only you can do. We love you, Lord. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, that you promise that you will never leave us or forsake us, and that you walk with us always. If there's anyone here this morning that does not know you as their Lord and Savior, may this be their day. And may you take each of us where we are and draw us closer to your heart. May we go to deeper places with you. So, Father, we're all yours this morning. We want to give you every single bit of our attention. Our eyes are on you, God. We look to you, and we are saved. We thank you, Father. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Okay. Well, good morning. Isn't this a little different? Here we are. It's 9:30, and we are all gathering. Want to welcome you if you're here visiting. I know that the Jones family, Bobby Joe and Brooks family, is here visiting. We welcome you guys. Yay. And anybody else that's visiting, we welcome you here this morning. Melanie and Emma have a gift bag for you back at guest services. So please fill out your Connect card on the bottom of your bulletin. And if you have any prayer requests or you have anything that you want to get involved with, your Connect card is where you get connected. Big announcement for today is that we are not going to be in the St. Patrick's Day Parade. There's been so much sickness in this house with our families and our youth that, and with the weather, the decision was made last night that we would not be in the parade. So that part is no longer, you don't need to meet the bus. Marked Men Retreat is coming up in March, and it's not too late to sign up. Emery is here this morning. He'll be around, he's in the back right now, and he'll be around after church. What an amazing, the testimonies that have come from the men that have taken those few days to go away and to be in the presence of the Lord uninterrupted, and what God has done, the healing, the restoring. Just want to invite you to talk to Emery if God's stirring it up in you, because a lot of times you get stirred up and you're like, nah, but take that step of faith and go on that retreat. It's going to be great. Celebrate Recovery started this past week on Tuesday night. It was an informational meeting and a prayer meeting, and it really gets going this week, 7 o'clock on Tuesday night. I just want to tell you, I walked into that room the other night, and I felt like I had walked into a family reunion of people that were just, it was full of love and joy, and it was awesome. And so you are invited to be a part of that. If you want more information on Celebrate Recovery, I know I saw Amanda and James here this morning, and they'll be glad to talk to you about it. But it's a great program for anything that hinders us in our relationship with God, any kind of hang-ups that we may have. So just want to call your attention to that. And we also need some help with some areas in serving. I know this morning we were maybe a little bit short on greeters, but I took the opportunity to throw my coat on and go outside and greet, and I love it. It's an awesome way to meet people. We need help with greeting. We need help with guest services. We need help with first impressions, which is decorating our home and making it welcome for people for our holidays and then throughout the year, and also with our Kingdom Kids ministry. So if that's you, there's an email on your bulletin. Just let us know, and we'll get you plugged in somewhere. But it was great to be outside this morning in the snow. Wasn't that awesome? And then Heidi, a little Heidi, she came running up. She's like, Miss Catherine, don't you want to catch snowflakes on your tongue? And it is great to be out there and greeting and meet everybody as they come in. And lastly, we want to share that this Friday night, Dare Challenge, who we love dearly, they're going to be leading our Friday night service. And so come out on Friday night to support them, to hear them, and to hear the miraculous things, the restoration that God is doing in their lives. And so we welcome you here this morning.
Hallelujah. What a special time. Would the ushers please come forward this morning? I was asked to take up the offering this morning, and I asked God, what is on your heart? What would you have me say? And he says, what I want is your heart, your whole heart. He's saying to us what his wants in this offering is, to give me your whole heart. He said, I gave you my son, my whole son, for your sins. So give me your heart. I raised him up, and I will raise you up when the day comes. So that's what I heard this morning. I believe that's what God's word is this morning. He wants our heart. I thought about how many times I've tried to give him all of my heart and then went take back a little piece here and there. So as we take up the offering this morning, receive, and that's a fact, that's a truth. I was reminded about the lady who put in the copper coin, and he said, this lady put in more than all the rest because she gave all that she had. So he wants all of our heart. So, Father, as we take up this offering, Father, we give it unto you, and we ask your presence, Father, upon it. And, Father, we know that if we give our heart, you will take it, and you will bless it. And for we ask that blessing in the name of Jesus. And we invite the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit in this house to do the work that you intended to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, you all. I don't know about you. I know a lot of you folks are not real fond of snow. I'm a transplant from Connecticut. And so evolution has been working on me the last 50 years or so. And I've adapted, but I got to tell you, I have shaken off the shackles. I like it much better here than up there. We've been camped in the book of 1 Corinthians in chapter 13 for several weeks, you'll remember, in a series called The More Excellent Way. We're going to continue that this morning, but we're going to look at a little different dimension. Just for context, 1 Corinthians 13 is the famous chapter about love. But it's in the book of 1 Corinthians, and it's sandwiched between, as you might expect, chapter 12 and chapter 14. So far, so good. All right. Chapter 12 and chapter 14 have to do with spiritual gifts. It's no accident that 13 is here. Paul is not trying to change the subject. The Corinthians were very hung up about spiritual gifts and who had them and who didn't. Paul's purpose in 13, and you can see it in the very first verse, is now I will show you the more excellent way. The gifts are one thing, but love is the platform on which the gifts operate. If there ain't no love, there ain't no gifts. Okay? We are now as verses 6 through 8. Last week, Jamie gave us a message about what it means to honor others. And so far in 1 Corinthians, Paul has talked about love is gracious, love is kind, right? It doesn't hold wrongdoings, okay? And these are sort of statements that, you know, I can identify with because I can do those things some of the time. He's changing up on us now with verse 6 through 8a. Let's look at the text today. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. What Paul has done is really raise the bar here on us. Okay? Because I can be gentle, I can be kind. That's what he prescribes the first 5 verses, right? But now he's saying always. I don't know about you, but always doesn't work for me with these things. So let's take a look at a little grid I've put together. This is the take-home test. We're not going to ask you to fill this out now and get graded or anything, okay? But I don't know about you, but have you ever received these surveys which you have to answer always, sometimes never, right? You get these things in the mail and, you know, I don't know. Do you dream at night? Always, sometimes, never, right? I hate these things because essentially what somebody is doing is they're looking for pre-information from me. But that's my fleshy heart. I don't like that. Okay? So you've got this in your bulletin. What I want you to do is mentally just think about now where your check marks would appear with respect to the, to today's text. And again, we're not going to mark you. We're not going to hold you responsible. You don't have to hand it in. Now I want you to look again at it and ask this question. If Paul's not talking about me, if he's not talking about you, who's he talking about? He's talking about Jesus. Because Jesus' love always protects. Jesus' love never fails. So you see the way Paul has kind of switched this up? There's a passage in Scripture, and before we get into it, I just ask that you would join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you with eager and open hearts. And we ask that you would make the Scripture our text and the Holy Spirit our teacher and your greater glory our supreme concern. In the name of Jesus, amen. I'd like you to grab a Bible if you don't have one. There should be one within a couple of seats of you. And let's go to the Gospel of John, chapter 8. And we're going to look at the first 11 verses, I guess it is, of chapter 8. Now keep your finger over there in 1 Corinthians 13, 6 through 8. Let's start with verse 2. At dawn, he appeared again in the temple courts, where all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do you say?" They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "If any of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone at her." Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who had heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left with the woman still standing there. Jesus asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No one, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. "Go now and leave your life of sin." In the Jewish law, direct from the tablets given to Moses, and you can find this in Leviticus 20, verse 10, the penalty for adultery was death. But if you go back and read the actual law, it says both the adulterer and the adulteress will be put to death. The rabbi is between 1500 BC and 33 AD. Had put together a series of interpretations of God's law, okay? And one of the interpretations with respect to this particular aspect of God's law, this particular law, was there had to be two eyewitnesses for this law to be operative. For the death penalty to be imposed, there had to be two eyewitnesses. Now let's think about that. Eyewitnesses to the very act of adultery. First of all, where is the guy? Eyewitnesses to the very act. They didn't bring the guy in, they brought her in. Maybe the guy was one of them. At the very least, this is a setup. This lady's been set up. Why? Because they want to trap Jesus, and she's collateral damage. You with me? Okay. So this is all trumped up, conjured up. Let's look at the first part of the 1 Corinthians scripture from today, verse 6. Love does not delight in evil. And we see in chapter 8 of John, they were using this question as a trap, right? In order to have a basis for accusing him. So it's clear their intent was evil. But he does not delight in evil. His love does not delight in evil. So he turns the tables. Right? Let's look at the next verse. Does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. If any one of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone at her. Bam. Paul in Romans 1 tells us that even if we've never heard the gospel, every human being has the law of God written on their heart. We know when we's wrong. David said, in sin my mother conceived me. He didn't mean his mother was committing sin in the act that gave rise to the conception. He meant, from the moment of conception, I'm sinful. And he was writing about every human being who ever lived, except one. Right? And we saw the effect that Jesus had on the group of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, because at this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first. The teachers of the law, this essentially was, since Israel's government and the religion were one, we're talking about the Justice Department here of the nation in these people, okay? It's the Attorney General and his staff. There is no higher authority in the nation of Israel than these guys. If they say you're going to get stoned, you're going to get stoned. Go to the next one. Jesus' love always protects. We're in verse 7 now of 1 Corinthians 13. He straightened up and said to them, if any of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone at her. He straightened up. Now he's talking to the Attorney General eye to eye. But the effect of his question is to provide protection to her and in fact save her life. Because the Spirit was coming out of Jesus at this point in time and convicting the hearts of the Attorney General and all the lawyers on his staff. Right? How about we go to the next one? Always trusts. Remember now, this is speaking about love. The text in 1 Corinthians 13 says, love always trusts. What I'm submitting to you, that it's only the love of Jesus that always trusts. Did he trust here? Was Jesus trusting in this woman? Think about the text. Think about the passage. Is he not presuming? That she is going to have the grace to leave her life of sin? Jesus is God. He's all just. If there were no hope here for this woman, he could not in good conscience say that their accusation was wrong. They arrived at it by a deceitful means, but the sin was the sin, and the law was the law. Right? But he's trusting that she is salvageable. Okay? That she's got a future. This sin doesn't define her. Even if she doesn't have faith in herself, he sees something here. And it's the same thing with that he always hopes. That's why he says to her at the end, go and sin no more. Because he knows that with the power of the Spirit and with his grace, she can. She can't without it, but she can with it. Go now and leave your life of sin. Next one. Always perseveres. Again, Paul is saying love always perseveres. And in the natural, we all know, and some of us have experienced a lot of tragedy in this area, that love does not persevere. But his love does. And he has seen this trial of this woman through to the end. And he's provided a way out by totally disarming the effect of her sin and her accusers. Right? If you flip a few pages over to chapter 13 in John and read 13 verse 1. They've come into the upper room. It's the night before he will be crucified. And verse 13:1 says, it was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. He loved them to the very end of his life. And many of these characters were not that lovable. In fact, one of them is going to betray him. But there's no exclusion here of, well, I love everybody except those who betray me. There's no exclusion of, I love everybody except those who don't commit adultery. He perseveres so well that he's hung on a cross the next day in our place, right? But Sunday's coming. And that's the moment of complete victory. So Shelley, next slide, please. So here it is. This is an eyewitness account of something that really happened in the first century. All right? In a little corner of the temple courts, probably in the court of women, since a woman was admitted here, right, which is an outer court, they were not allowed on the inside. This really happened, and she escaped with her life. But I would submit to you that this story, this eyewitness account, yeah, it describes one unique event that occurred in 33 AD, apparently early in the morning, which would make sense. That's when, you know, the eyewitnesses would be bringing in an adulteress. But there's a much bigger story here. It's a cosmic story. Because here's what I want you to think about. The text tells us that he stooped down and wrote with his finger, right, on the ground. This is God. Colossians 1:16 tells us he created all things. And all things were created by him and for him. He made this dust. But 1,500 years before this, in the form of I am, on the top of Mount Sinai, he came down in thunder, in lightning, in cloud, in darkness, to meet with the mediator of that day, Moses. And Moses took from him some tablets, which scripture tells us he wrote on with his finger. Those tablets contained the law, thou shalt not commit adultery. Written in stone, rather permanent, with his finger. 1,500 years later, he's here in the temple courts, in the flesh, writing on the ground with his finger. Because the Father's love was so great for his lost children that he and his Son and the Holy Spirit devised and hatched a plan to rescue all of those adulterers, all of those liars, all of those thieves. And so God stooped down from heaven. He left his throne. He stooped down and he got eye to eye that woman. Shelley, if you go back to that. And I submit to you, I mean, a lot of ink has been spilled. Tons of books have been written about what was Jesus writing in the dust. Okay? Holy Spirit is telling us you don't need to know. Okay? You don't need to know. But the point is, the finger of God established that first law, and the finger of God has the ability, because of his Son stooping down to earth, has the ability to erase those sins. That woman went in there that day, and she was going to die. Her life was over. She was facing death, square in the face, and there was no doubt she was going to die. And there is no doubt, Scripture tells us, that outside of Jesus, we are going to die. Because as David said, in sin my mother conceived me. But the Son of God came. And convicted the Attorney General and all the lawyers, okay? And I would submit to you that in the cosmic sense, the Attorney General and all the lawyers are all of our sins we've heaped on ourselves. But he disarms them and their effect. Out a free woman that day. Now, what happened to her? Holy Spirit decided we don't need to know that either. But she was given freedom. And she didn't do anything for it. Okay? So it wasn't a matter of going back to that questionnaire and trying to modify her behavior to make it happen so that my love never fails. Well, I'll always trust. It's not about behavior modification. We can't do it. That's the point. He does it. And he does it by the blood that he spilt. I don't know where we are. I guess we're about right. I don't know if anyone is here who hasn't experienced that unchaining. I know you've experienced that inward knowledge that your life is a mess, because that's true of all of us in here. What I'm offering you is the opportunity to have that mess lifted off your shoulders and out of your heart. And all you need to do is come before him, not even physically. You don't have to get down on the ground like she is. But sincerely pray, because he hears. Lord, I've made a mess of it. I've tried to fix it. Have failed spectacularly. And I know, because I'm not a quick study. 40 years I failed spectacularly. But I'm going to give it up to you, Jesus. And I want you to be the Lord of my life. Okay? You often hear the phrase, Jesus wants you to give up your life. That's true in a certain sense. That he wants you to give him your life. But there's another sense in which we have to admit, Jesus doesn't want my life. My life's a mess. Here's the thing. He wants to give you his life. That's the difference. Once you have his life by his grace, then there are no more chains. It's not that you're not going to fall. You will, but you're not going to be chained by the failures anymore. And you're going to move through this process of growing closer and closer to Him by His grace. You okay with that?
Yes.
So I'd like to just open the front here for anyone who'd like to come forward for prayer. If the elders had come up and prayer team. I don't know if we got a contract with the worship team or are they done? They're coming. Good. Excellent. And I'd submit to you that He is here in the form of these folks, actually, who want to pray with you, encourage you. If you're just getting started on this journey, to get you started, maybe you need to refresh your journey. We can help refresh you by the grace of God. Okay, you guys? Thanks. Please.
I prayed this morning, but we were given this word that that the Lord was healing eyes this morning and that He was applying the honey of His word to our physical and our spiritual eyes. So in light of now this message that Bill shared with us this morning, I just want to speak that over us today, that if this word is for you, apply it to your physical and your spiritual eyes and be healed. So if Chris is here this morning, come up and get prayer.
Stand and worship with us.
In the beginning, you were singing, and in the air still me, sing over me. And in this moment, you're right beside me. Everywhere you're in the air that I breathe. In the beginning, you were singing. In the end, still me. Singing over me. In this moment, you're right beside me. Everywhere you're in the air that I breathe. You are an endless ocean. Bottomless sea. You are an endless ocean. Bottomless sea. You are an endless ocean. Bottomless. Thank you. said, you keep loving. There's no end to your forgiveness, mercy. And every morning you can come in. The waves of your affection keep washing over. Angels, they are singing in this ocean, and they still can find no shore. Day and night, night and day.